And good morning and welcome to Rodeo Sunday at New Hope Community Church. It is great to have you with us today. How many of you have been to the rodeo already? Raise your hand. All right, good, good. All right. How many's going this afternoon for the finals? Okay, I'll see you there. All right? All right, it'll be good. How many of you had a tri-tip sandwich? Okay, all right, good. Yeah, that might be the best reason to go, all right, is for the tri-tip sandwich. The Chardon boys and their family, the same ones who barbecue for us twice a year, do those out at the rodeo. So say hi to them. They've been working hard for 3 days. But it's great to have you with us. If you are a guest here at New Hope today, thanks. And we hope you won't stay a guest long. We hope you become part of the family. But there is a guest card in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by a little later in the service, and then next week through the mail, we'll send you information about the church. We promise we will not beat on your door, we'll not bother you on the phone, but we'll send you information that we hope will answer most of your questions and let you know about what goes on around New Hope Church. But thanks for being here. Let me highlight just a couple of announcements and then a few prayer requests, and we'll get engaged in our worship this morning. There are some ladies that are wearing matching shirts in service today. So why don't y'all stand up, all right? Those of you with matching shirts, please stand, all right? All right, notice around here. All of these ladies went, I noticed some of y'all have some rhinestones on them and others don't, man. You guys kind of dolled them up. All right, good, good. Thank you. Be seated. This group of ladies all went to women's retreat last weekend. And I understand there was about 12, yeah, there they are, about 25 of them all together went up. And so, Fawn, tell me, did you have a good time?
Yeah.
All right, now, hold on, now, you're the leader. Okay, the rest of you who went, did you have a good time?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, just. Okay, just wanted to make sure, all right, she's telling us the truth here today. And let's see here. What ladies, right? Would you go again next year?
Of course, yes.
All right. Would you invite somebody else to go with you next year?
Of course.
All right. Good, good, good. So, ladies, when you hear the announcement next year about going on another retreat, all right, you might want to sign up. They had a great time. Fawn, any just a little update you want to give us about how it went? Catch you at the spur of the moment here, but.
It was just wonderful.
Never known you to be short of words, though. Or short, so, you know.
No, it was a wonderful, wonderful time. It's always good for us ladies, you know what I'm talking about, to just get away where we don't have to do anything. Somebody cooks for us, we don't have to make our beds. It was wonderful in that way, just a nice, relaxing weekend. But God was there, and we got such a powerful message through the special speaker. I would venture to say all 25 of us that were there were definitely touched and opened up to something new that God was speaking to us. So we all went home. You can't go wrong when God's moving in your life. And we really did that with him all our life. So it was wonderful. And on top of that, just wonderful fun.
Good. One of the ladies at 8 o'clock service who had, there were a couple ladies at 8 o'clock service had the shirts on. They said what was really, they loved about the shirts is that there were 25 people from New Hope, but they said if you went to one service, you didn't know the ladies from the other service. So when you're walking around up there, you could identify, oh, you go to the same church I do. And so they could do things together that way. So that was pretty cool. So that was a great idea, and they loved that. So anyway, ladies, we're glad you had a great time. Please notice in the bulletin there is a kind of an announcement about a letter writing event coming up. All right. For Mother's Day. And so Pastor Nick is the one sponsoring this. We're going to make one change in this, though. Instead of the date being this Wednesday that you have to have the letters written by about your mother, it's the following Wednesday. All right, so the first Wednesday in May. 3 days is not enough time for you to think about that letter. So this is a letter that you would write to your mother. All right, and what would you say to her? Whether she is still living or not, you can write this letter, all right? And there's going to be a special prize, all right, to someone that Nick thinks was the most moving or touching letter that was written, and also a special thing done in honor of your mom, all right? So he'll let you know about that on Mother's Day. So if you have some writing skills or you would just like to take the opportunity to sit and write about your mom, read that and have it in by no later than a week from this coming Wednesday, all right? There's going to be a special night coming up at the end of May where we can meet right here in this room, and we're going to watch the big screen movie, all right? Our small group sponsors, Corey and Teddy, are putting that event together. You don't have to be part of a small group to come to movie night. Just come and enjoy the movie, and they've put in a couple of things there. And Teddy, or Corey, or either one of you, or both of you in this service. Teddy, I have a question for you. Or if anybody from Hope Group Number 2 is here. Okay, Hope Group Number 2 is requesting an entrance fee that night. You know how sometimes you can go to a football game and they'll let you in for a couple of cans of canned vegetables? Well, we're going to let you into the movie for a package of underwear. Okay, Group 2. So here's my question. Okay, I have to ask Corey. Okay, because here's what I want to know. Are these Fruit of the Loom kind of underwear or Depends? No, that's not a bad thing, all right? Depends. Haven't you been seeing the commercials for Depends lately? I mean, they're modeling down the street, all right, in Depends. So they're good. And, huh? But no, I want to know what they're for so we can bring appropriate, you know. And is this all sizes? And is this both sexes, all right? You know, because there's a difference, okay? All right, so I just want clarification. We'll have that for you by next Sunday, all right, because it matters. All right, there's ways in which you can be volunteering and some new ways that maybe you haven't thought of before. Check that out and see if you can help out. The Actus update, our family that is going, they're leaving the mission field in Colombia. They're heading to the mission field in Uganda. And if you have been praying about what you want to contribute, put that in today, all right? Guys, I got great news for you. We're probably going to exceed what the goal was. A month ago, we needed $21,000, all right? And as of last night, we were $155 short of that, all right? So that's awesome. You all have been incredible. So if you pray, now, just because I said that amount that you'd prayed about, you had in your head, don't say, well, I don't need to do that now. No, go ahead, put it in, and it will go towards their expenses. I'm sure they can use a little bit extra, all right, in the process. But I just say thank you for your generosity in making that possible. I think I have enough time. I want to share this with you. Matt shared it with me this week when he stopped by the office. He said, Tim, our travel agent called us about 3 weeks ago to ask us if we were ready for him to purchase our tickets. He had found a very good price, leaving on the 15th of May. And he said, Tim, at that moment, as of 3 weeks ago, he said, we had received less than $600 for our launch fund. He said, we hadn't been to New Hope yet, but he said, we had received less than $600. And he said, I told him, you know, I'll call you back tomorrow. I want to talk with Shelley. And he said, we want to talk about it. So he said, Shelley and I talked about it, we prayed about it, and said, you know, part of this process is our steps of faith. And so they said, after we prayed, we said, yes, go ahead and buy them. He said, when we called them the next day, those tickets were gone. And so he said, well, do you want me to buy the next close? He said, the next closest to that date of departure. So the guy called him back in a few minutes, and he said, you know what? He said, 3 days later, on May the 18th, I found tickets for even less than what they were on the 15th. And so Matt said, buy them. He said, Tim, the next day we got our first sizable check of $1,500. And he said, the day after that, he said, we got about four or five checks that equaled about $2,200. And he said, then we came to New Hope. And he said, and within a week, he said, you showed me what had already been promised. And he said, that was a valuable lesson for Shelley and I to realize that all of this is not always we don't always know way down the road where we're going to be, but what the next step is. And we take that step of faith, and then God honors. And he did in that case. And I just thought that was a great testimony. So, anyway, those are a few things that are going on. Dad and I leave in the morning at 8:15. We arrive to the airport at 6 to 6:30, and we leave on the honor flight to Washington, D.C. with 60 other. Phil Wright, all right, and his granddaughter and great-grandson are getting to go. All of us went to a little event, a little gathering of everybody to get instructions for them to give us our swag, all right? And our swag is a bag. Dad, the vets have a red one. The guardians have a blue one. That way we can tell them apart. We all got a shirt, red, blue. We all got hats, red, blue, all right? And they kind of went over the itinerary, told us what time to arrive. He told a short little story that said, you know, World War II veterans are never late. They're always early. But he reminded these vets, he said, you don't need to show up like one of them did at 3:15 and sat in the airport for 3 hours till he was supposed to arrive. So, Dad, Phil, 6 o'clock, early enough, okay? But the departure is about 8:15. Any of you see Channel 26 Friday night and saw Dad on the news? All right, good, good, all right. Yeah, they called spur of the moment, needed a quick little promo for it, and so Dad said there was an old guy in that spot. So anyway, we're really looking forward to that. Be praying for us as we're gone. A couple of surgeries this week. Jerry Sperling's going to have surgery on her knee tomorrow, and we hope that doesn't get canceled. And let's see here, Wednesday, right, Helen? All right, just found that out. Helen goes to Sacramento and has her next surgery on Wednesday. Hopefully she will be home by Saturday. So please be remembering to pray for Helen Heath. And then Shelly's not sitting up here next to me. I whispered to Chick during our opening song. It wasn't very worshipful. Not the song, what I said to him, all right? I whispered to Chick, and I said, you're not as pretty as the person I usually stand next to up here. Do what? Nor as tall. Oh, that wasn't nice. That wasn't nice, all right? But Shelly is home with Ashley. Ashley, we spent till about 3:15 in the morning, Saturday morning, at ER with her. Something's not right with her thyroid. Her counts are way out of whack, so it creates lots of symptoms. And so she is home with her today, so do remember her. So those are a few of the updates we wanted to bring to your attention. We're going to have our morning tithes and offerings, and we are in for a little treat today. All right, we have, I believe, your first time to play for us at New Hope Church. All right, so for our offertory today, we have Miss Mueller, who is going to come and play for us. So if you would take your place up there, be ready to go. Round of applause. All right, and before you're seated, tell them where you go to school. Granite Ridge. And what grade are you in at Granite Ridge? 8th grade, so soon to be progressing to Close North. All right, terrific. Well, thank you for coming to play for us today. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, we love you. We thank you for the life that you share with us. Father, when I pause long enough to think about that fact, when I pause long enough to think about the eternal God, the creator of the universe, the one who knows all things, the one who can do anything he chooses, the one who is timeless. He doesn't have a beginning and he doesn't have an end. And when I realize the fact that you want to spend time with me, that you want to hang out with us, that you want to live every moment of every day of the rest of our lives with us, it boggles my mind, blows me away. And Father, I'm afraid that I far too often take that for granted. And so, Lord, I trust in the quietness of this moment that each of us will just take a brief time and think about the incredible lengths that you've gone to and the different ways that you have expressed to us that you love us and you want to spend all eternity with us. And Father, that eternity doesn't begin when we die, but it begins today. And Father, you want to be part of the journey as Dad and I are taking to D.C. tomorrow. You want to be part of the building of memories that we create in these next few days as we reflect back on old memories. Father, you want to be a part of this worship service that all of us are in at this very moment. You want to be part of our work activity tomorrow, wherever our job takes us. You want to be part of our family life today. And that, Father, not only do you want to be a part of our life, but you would like to reflect your life through the adventure of our life. So in a trip like tomorrow, and in a work day like tomorrow, and in an activity-filled afternoon like today, you want to reflect yourself in us in all those various places. Father, teach us today from your word how this relationship, this time that we spend together, can really make a difference, not only in us, but how your life in us can make a difference in the world we are a part of, and how it makes a difference for all eternity. Our lives are filled with your purpose. That ought to put a smile on our face every morning. Father, thank you for the privilege we have today to worship you in music, in prayer, in the study of your scriptures. May we invest this time in you. May we allow you to invest your life through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I forgot to share with you during announcements that there's a significant event that transpired within our church family this week, and that is there is a co-ed New Hope softball team. For the first time in over a decade, they played their first game this week. They won. 11-8. Doug Cecil, where are you? Doug is our fearless leader. He's the one who said, hey, do we have a softball team? No, let's have one. So he organized it, made the arrangements. We play at Bethany Church, all right, on Thursday evenings. Fawn plays on the team, all right. I play on the team. I was really going to just be a cheerleader, but they gave me a shirt and put me out in the field, and I was feeling really good about it, all right, till after, and we were having some pizza. And Fawn looks across the table and says, I'm sure glad you're playing. Now I'm not the oldest one on the team. So I've recruited Cecil Spurlock to start playing with us now so that I don't have to be the oldest guy on the team. But anyway, it was fun. We'll decide after this next week whether we're going to post our schedule and invite people to come watch or not. All right? We kind of like an anonymity. All right? It works out pretty good, but it was fun. Let me ask you a question. How many of you are beginning to think about your next vacation? Okay, I don't know about you, but when I get home from my last one, I'm thinking about my next vacation, all right? Oh, it's always exciting to think about where you're going. And I actually Googled a question this week, and that was, how do you plan for a trip? One of the things I love about Google is you can ask it anything, and it will have some kind of response for you, all right? And there were lots of things to choose from, and there was one that said the 10 essential things you should do in preparing for vacation. And so I clicked on it. And what I loved about it once I read it is, wow, my mom and dad were good, all right? I didn't realize there was this checklist in my own mind that had been created by going on vacation with my parents as a kid and going on vacation with my parents as an adult. I didn't realize they were just things that seem to be automatic that you think about and do, but lots of people don't do them, and that's why somebody created this list. And I'm going to share just a little bit off that list with you, not all 10 things, but just in case you're getting ready to go on a trip, this might be helpful. The first thing that caught my attention in this one article was this first quote: airfare, hotel accommodations, and rental cars may be the holy trinity of preparation. I love that line. That tells me this guy's probably a believer. At least he understood Holy Trinity, all right? He saw how valuable that was in your spiritual life, so these three things had that equal value in your vacation life. Here's a few things that were on that list. Contact your house sitter or kennel in advance of your departure. That's a good plan, all right? Number two, take care of stop orders and advance payments. In other words, stop things like mail and newspapers so they don't collect unless you have a house sitter who's going to do that for you. The third one was interesting, managing your cash flow. And what I found fascinating about this is something I learned from my grandfather and my dad, and that is have cash in your pocket. Okay? Now, I know you 20-somethings. You have no idea what that is. Okay? You have a thing called a debit card, and that's what you use every place. But, you know, if you're traveling, you sometimes find your place in situations that don't have those kind of things, so you need some cash in your pocket. Plus, you tend to pay fees at other ATMs, all right, to get your own money out. So get cash, anticipate what you might need before you go. This just seems so obvious to me. Plan your first day. You would go on a vacation and not have a plan of some sort, you know, but plan your first day. This article said many people's vacation is ruined because they didn't give any thought to their first day. Map out your trip, okay? Most of us know where we want to go. Now we got to figure out how to get there, all right? So map it out. Last one I'll throw out at you. Check the weather. That's, again, I love smartphones, all right? You could just, I've been checking Washington, D.C. weather for 3 weeks, all right? And it's changed 5 times, all right, in 3 weeks. But the good news, it changed for the better. 3 weeks ago, it was going to be 81 on our last day there, and 81 in D.C. could be 81 and humid. Now, it's only going to be a high of 68, okay? That's going to be nice, all right? That's good for pushing wheelchairs. All right, so it's going to be really nice and pleasant. No rain expected, so don't have to worry about rain gear, all right? Otherwise, I'd show up and be one of those dweebs with a newspaper over my head, all right? Because you didn't bring appropriate stuff. Some of you are saying, why in the world are you talking about this morning? Well, there's a reason to the madness. You see, just as there is a process to vacations, there is also a process to life's transformations. It doesn't just happen by accident. Vacations just don't happen by accident. And these things don't happen just by osmosis. You guys remember science, right? You remember what osmosis is? You know, the interchange through the membranes of the cells, all right, just kind of flows back and forth. Well, just because you sit in church doesn't mean that you're going to have life transformation. Just because you sleep with your Bible on the nightstand doesn't mean there's going to be this free exchange of biblical truth into your life. It doesn't happen that way. There is a process. The scripture says it this way: we must know the truth. And when we know the truth will do what for us? Set us free. But you gotta know the truth. That's part of the process. You see, what shapes and determines the process in both endeavors, vacations and life transformation, is an answer to a key question. Where do I want to go? That's a very key question to a vacation. Where do I want to go? You see, if you don't have a plan, what's going to happen on your vacation is what happens on a Friday night when you ask your wife, where do you want to go for dinner? And then you guys play the game for the next 15 minutes. I don't know. I don't care. Where do you want to go? Oh, I don't know. I don't care. Where do you want to go? And then we man up and make a decision, and they say, I don't want to go there. Yeah, y'all have been there, huh? Yeah. So we need to have the plan for vacation. We need to have the plan in life. Where do you want to go? And in asking that question, it's not just the destination that's important, but it's the process to arrive at the destination. That's true with a vacation. It's true with our life. I remember on the third Thursday of June in 1960 when I invited Jesus Christ in my life, and there were some adults who didn't think that a 5-year-old boy knew what he was doing, and they asked me the question. They said, why did you invite Jesus Christ in your life? And my answer was this: because I want to go to heaven. I was very clear at that moment what my destination was going to be. I wished I'd been as clear at that moment about the process between that moment and the time that I will eventually arrive in heaven. But we have to first of all answer that question, where do I want to go? And just briefly before I move on, because there may be some of you here who you know where you'd like to go, but you haven't made that initial step of getting there. You see, you don't go, just as you don't go on vacation by accident, you won't end up in heaven by accident. By apathy, you can't end up in hell. By postponing a decision, you can end up in hell. But I promise you, you will not end up in heaven by accident. That's a choice that you must make. It's a choice to have a relationship with God. This God who loves you so much, He's personal. This God who loves you so much, He's provided a way of salvation for us. That way of salvation is evidenced by the cross that you see on the screen and that wooden cross you would see behind the screen. It is the message of Easter, that God so loved the world He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him would not perish but have everlasting life. And maybe you came this morning not having any idea what the message was going to be about, but you don't need the rest of the sermon, you need this moment. You need this moment. Somebody's already been planting the seed in your life for years that you need a personal relationship with Jesus. Others in your life, family members and relatives and neighbors, have been watering that seed saying, hey, you need to make this choice. Don't put it off any longer. And maybe you just roamed in here today, and this is the day that you need to let that plant, that seed and that water come to fruition in your life. And you just need to take a couple of seconds at this very moment and say, Lord Jesus, I want you to come live in my life. You see, in case you don't remember, that's what last Sunday's sermon was all about. This life of transformation starts, it has to have a starting point, and it starts with, do you remember what we talked about last week? How does this life of transformation begin in us? It was a three-word sermon theme last week. I know you've slept seven times since then, so that's hard. I described it this way. This needs to be the hub and the core of our life. What was I talking about? Who is to be the hub and core of our life? Christ, the presence of God in us. This is where the life of transformation begins. The presence of God in us. Without the presence of God in us, this life of transformation will not take place. You might house train the dog. You might learn how to behave a little nicer. But transformation will not take place apart from the presence of God, the Creator, inside His creation. Now that's where it starts. And if you've never done that, why don't you pause just for a moment? You don't even have to bow your head and nobody will look at you. But the quietness of your own mind, why don't you say, Lord Jesus, this is why I came here today. I want to invite your son to live in my life. I'm ready to start this process, and I can't take the next step until I make this step. I invite you to come live within my life. Now, for the vast majority of us here, we've already had that prayer. We've already had that decision-making moment where we have invited Jesus Christ to come live within us. His presence resides in us. But that's not all there is to this journey of transformation. In fact, what I've come to discover and come to believe is that process of transformation never ends. I really have to be honest. I'll make this confession. I kind of thought that transformation process probably ended when I died and went to heaven because now I'm perfect. But you know what? Just because I die and go to heaven doesn't mean I'm God. When I die and go to heaven, I will be perfect, but I don't think my ability to love stops growing. I think I now have the capacity for endless love, so it will continue to grow. I don't think my capacity to have peace gets stunted. I think that capacity will continue to flood my soul. The capacity to be able to worship will continue to expand. The capacity for joy will just continue to run over. I will now have the capacity to experience more and more of what God has for me. But the process never ends. It just goes from imperfect to perfect. But the capacity continues to expand. So, if we have the presence of God in us, what is the next step of this process? I would define it to you this way. It will be the revolution of the mind. There's a civil war that takes place here. And you and I have to make the choices that have the intent that describe the fact that we care about God with every choice that we make. And that is the revolution of the mind, changing it from the things of this world to the things that matter to God. If you'd like to turn in your Bibles to the book of Philippians, it is toward the latter part of the New Testament. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. It's east of Romans, okay? If you've studied the Bible long, been around church very much, you know that the book of Philippians is known as the book of joy. Paul, writing from a prison cell, describes what the kind of joy that Jesus Christ offers to us is like. And I think the fact that he wrote it from a prison cell adds punch to the message, because he's not talking about the joy of God when everything in his life is great. And that is a sign of spiritual maturity in Paul's life, and that will be a sign of spiritual maturity in your life, that when the chips are down, when life isn't good, that you have joy. That you don't live life on the roller coaster of the emotions of your circumstances, but you live life in the consistency of the fullness of Jesus Christ in us. And Paul illustrates for that as he writes the book of Philippians. With physical pain and misery going on all around him, he writes this book that is filled with joy. And in chapter 2, Paul restates the goal of spiritual growth in some pretty remarkable words when he says, If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if the fact that you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ brings you any encouragement, and if you find in this personal relationship with God, you have some comfort that comes because He loves you, and if in the common sharing of the Spirit, the fact that God now, by the person of the Holy Spirit, lives within you, if there is any tenderness and compassion in you, so he gives some qualifiers, if these things are true about where you are, then, Paul says, make my joy complete. By all of you who have had these things take place in your life, then not only let it be individual in you, but collectively, I want you to be like-minded. I want all of you together to have the same love. I want you to be one in spirit and one in mind. And I want all of you individually and collectively to do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but rather in humility. Humility is not walking around with your head down and your eyes cast away from folks. Humility is not being a doormat. He says, here's what humility is. You value others above yourself. You look to the interests of others before you look for your own. Paul restating what Jesus said in his own ministry, when Jesus said you can summarize life and a relationship with God very easily. Love God with all that you are and love your neighbor as you love yourself. He plainly tells us to value others. He very distinctly instructs us to look to the interests of others. In the very next verse, verse 5 of chapter 2, Paul touts Jesus as the model when he says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset that Jesus Christ had. Have the same mindset. You see, what we think is important. Watchman Nee, a Chinese evangelist of a different generation, wrote a book called Sit, Walk, and Stand. A variety of others. Tells an incredible story that illustrates maybe what I'm trying to tell you today. He says there was a poor Christian Chinese farmer who had rice fields high up in the mountains of China. Every day he spent hours pumping water into his rice paddies. But when he returned to the fields the next morning, he would discover that his non-believing neighbor, who lived down the hill below him, had opened up the dikes of his field and drained the water out of his so that he could put them into his own field. For a while, this Christian ignored the injustice. But after several days, this became desperate, for his rice would die if this process continued. This was the man's livelihood and care for his family. So this Christian asked his church to gather, and he sought counsel and prayer with them. They discussed the situation, and together they came up with a plan. The next day, the Christian farmer rose early in the morning with some of his friends from church. They filled the neighbor's fields below him first with water, and then they filled his own. He counted his neighbor more significant than himself, and he looked to his neighbor's interests first. After several days of doing this, this unbelieving neighbor came up to his hut and asked the man whose water he had been stealing if he could tell him about this God that he loved that would prompt him to fill his fields first and then take care of his own. You see, Christ-like humility amazes people. And if you and I want to progressively become more like Jesus, we must progressively embrace this mindset that Jesus had. If we want to become like Jesus, we must first think like Jesus. So in our illustration of last week, after the presence of God is in our lives, after we have Him as the hub and the core of our life, we need to add think to the process. This is not just some intellectual pursuit, but rather it is adopting the state of mind, the truth of Christ as our very own. As we belong to Him, as we grow in Him, as we serve Him, we become like Him, and then we start to think like Him. This leads us to serve others just as we serve Him. I told you last week the reason for the next three sermons, last week, this week, and next week, it's because I want to try to put a bow around the previous 30 weeks that we spent studying Think, Act, and Believe. I want to try to help change some of you who thought, wow, 30 weeks was just too long. And I really want to help you understand it probably isn't long enough. Because this thing called the Christian life is an eternal marathon. It is not a short sprint. We're in this for eternity. Shelly and some other ladies in our church kicked off this last Friday night. I believe it's the third year of doing a group called Girls for God. It's taking junior high and high school girls for a period of time, 6 to 12 weeks, and just spending time pouring their lives into them and various truths and activities. And Shelly told me after she came home that first night, she said, I asked the girls a question that you had asked the previous Sunday. And she said, first of all, I asked them who was the hub and the core of their life. And then, what truths can you tell me about God? She said, that was probably kind of a heady question to throw out to junior high and high school girls on the first lesson. And she says, but once one of them began to talk, the others all chimed in and they began to come up with some things. And so I'm not going to ask you all to chime in, but let me ask you the question. If I ask you, what are five key truths that you build your life on? Could you give them to me? If I ask you what were 10 key doctrines that you think about, could you tell me? Okay, I'll ask you one. Well, what would be one key doctrine, truth that you build your life on? Faith in who? God, yeah, that's where it starts. Believing that God is. And it moves to this God who is personal. And this God who is personal, he provided a way of salvation so we can have a relationship with Him. And then this is where the real thinking kicks in. He's given us His Word so we can know more about Him and know more about ourselves. And these things, these are essential, guys, and you need to know about. It's why, you probably didn't even realize this, it's why there were keychains that were out there. Some of you picked these up. Some of you wouldn't cough up the $3. So then we even made them free, all right? They were on tables out there for a while. But 10 key doctrines, it tells you what the truth is, and then it tells you the scripture verse that goes along with it. Somebody ask you, could you give them, why do you believe that God exists? Could you give them a scripture verse? These things are important. It's what we build our life on. And you see, I want us to understand, we have to know the truth, and then we must apply the truth so that we can experience the freedom that God offers to us. You see, external virtues, let's pause there. If I ask you, what are the virtues of Christ, could you give me any virtues? I would hope you could, because we spent 10 weeks talking about them. You should have been able to have kicked off love, joy, peace, goodness, gentleness, meekness, hope, humility. But see, if you don't know this, you'll never get to this. This is necessary for this. So do you understand why it is really, really important to know these things? I didn't practice this right here. Okay. External virtue flows from an internal well of belief. If we have joy, for example, in our lives as evidenced by the testimony of people around us, so pause just a moment. If we were to ask your 10 closest friends, are you a person of joy? What would they say? It's just a thought. If that is true, if all of them would say, yeah, man, Ryan is a joy-filled guy. I love it. They would see that because there is an internal belief in you that's acting as a nutrient flowing through you to produce the fruit of joy in your life. But if Ryan were to lack joy, if his friends would say, no, Ryan's a nice guy, but he's not very joy-filled, then it would be because there is an internal belief that is missing. There is something in your life that's missing that you don't know. To use another example, let's consider a person who lacks the virtue of humility. This will likely be somebody who is lacking in the belief of their new identity in Jesus Christ. Let me explain. When we become Christians through faith in Christ, we are taught that we become the children of God and the heirs of God's kingdom. That's found in the 8th chapter of the book of Romans. Therefore, we are significant. When we become a Christian, we become significant when we discover that we are the child of God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ, that all that He has is now available to me. We are significant now because of our position as a child of God. And Christians who lack humility often brag about their achievements and their association with others, and they often do this so they can gain significance in their own eyes and the eyes of their friends. And this lack of humility signals the absence of this particular Christian belief that we are identified with Christ as a joint heir. If the believer wants to grow in humility, then believe in your identity in Jesus Christ. There's a story about a German artist named Albrecht Dürer. I should have told Eric and Milo about this sooner, and you could have flashed up this picture. Many of you you've seen at one time or another the portrait of the praying hands. It used to adorn almost every house you would go into in some place or another, but it has become a bit, unfortunately, outdated. But that picture illustrates the think, act, and be process of our personal transformations with Christ. You see, Dürer's father was a goldsmith, and he apprenticed his son in goldsmithing. In his very early years, he wanted him to have a trade. But Dürer loved artwork, painting portraits, and he really wanted to become a painter. His father finally gave in to the needs of his son, and he agreed that he could go to Nuremberg to study art. Unfortunately, though, his father wasn't wealthy enough to support his son, so the son had to work as a laborer to support himself. The trouble was, when he worked enough in order to provide enough to support doing artwork, he didn't have any time to do his artwork. But he had a friend, Franz Nickstein. I don't know if I'm saying that German name correctly or not, but Franz Nickstein. Did I say it right? Okay, close enough for an okie. Franz was also a gifted artist, but he was in the same boat. So they decided that they would cut the deck of cards, draw lots, but somehow a short straw. One would support the other while they finished his studies, and then when they had done enough artwork, they would support the other one out of their earnings so they could finish art school. Well, they drew lots, and Albrecht won. So Albrecht was able to devote himself to his art studies, and he agreed to support Franz after achieving success so his friend could finish his studies. Years later, Albrecht returned to find Franz so he could keep his end of the bargain. But when he got there, he discovered what kind of sacrifice his friend had made for him. You see, as Franz had worked at his labor, his fingers had become hard and calloused and stiff. His long, nimble, slender fingers and sensitive hands had been ruined by the hard labor he had to do to provide for both of them. He could no longer manage the delicate brushstrokes of an artist. But in spite of the price that he had paid, Franz was not bitter. He was very happy that his friend Albrecht had attained success. Well, one day, Albrecht saw his friend kneeling, his rough, calloused hands entwined in silent prayer. And Albrecht quickly sketched the hands of his friend, later using that sketch for the drawing that became world famous, known as the Praying Hands. By the way, you can Google that and you will find the artwork and you will find the story. He saw his friend's hands as a symbol of the love that Jesus had shown us, a self-giving love that preferred the good of loved ones to their own rights, a self-emptying love that chose servanthood over equality with God and the glory of the Father, the kind of humility that Paul talked about in Philippians chapter 2. The concepts that Jesus and his apostles ask you and I to believe are the nutrients that produce the fruit of the Spirit in our lives for others to benefit from, to taste. In John chapter 15, oh, there it is. You are so good, Milo. In John chapter 15, John shares the story that Jesus told of the vine-branch relationship. Jesus said, "I am the vine, and you are the branches. If you as a branch will abide in me as the vine, I will produce fruit in your life." The branch by itself has nothing in it to produce fruit. The nutrients to produce fruit is in the life of the vine. And would you and I put our life and we abide in the life of the vine, the life that is inside that vine flows through the branch, and fruit is produced. And Paul writes about that fruit in Galatians. It's this list here, plus hope and humility. And do you understand that fruit is produced not for the benefit of the fruit? An apple never looks in a mirror and says, "What a fine apple I am." An apple never bites itself and says, "Why? I taste good." No, the fruit is there for someone else to come by and say, "My, I've never seen a finer apple. My, I've never tasted a sweeter apple." God produces his character in your life and mine so that it benefits the lives of others. If it isn't stirring within us, the fruit will never mature and ripen on the branches of our lives for others to taste. In the beginning of the Believe series, we presented the concept of a belief that begins in the head and travels to the heart to make a difference. Our mind initially takes in information, we process it, we seek to understand it, we develop a point of view and thoughts and feelings about the proposition. The mind sends this information to the heart, and the heart decides what to do with it. If the heart rejects the idea, we may say in public that we understand. We might even say in public we believe it, but down deep, if our heart hadn't accepted what our mind has sent to the heart will never produce the intent of that thought in the mind. We live out of our hearts. It's our default mode. It's what we automatically go to. My mind might tell me telling the truth is always the right thing to do. But then somebody asks me a question, and I feel like if I answer it truthfully, I'll get blamed for something. What's my default mode? I might lie. I'll pick on you husbands again for a moment. Your wife walks out with a new dress on. She doesn't ask you, "Is this a pretty dress?" We could answer that one. But she asks you, "Does this make me look slimmer?" You believe, I'm confident, every one of you men believe telling the truth is always the right thing to do. But what do we do at that moment? More often than not, we lie. But in less humorous situations, what do we do? We have 50 shades of gray on the truth. And none of them are the right color. You see, the journey of belief begins in the head, but it has to migrate that 12 or 18 inches south to our heart to make a difference. And the reason that is so important, because the wise man in the book of Proverbs, chapter 23, verse 7, says this: as you think in your heart, so are you. As you think in your heart, so are you. The writer didn't say as you think in your mind, but he says as you think in your heart, there's a vast difference. Consider the context of the verse. Let me read it for you in its context. Verses 6 through 8 in Proverbs 23 says this: do not eat the bread of a miser, nor desire his delicacies, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. He says eat and drink, but he doesn't want you to. The morsel you have eaten, you will vomit up and waste your pleasant words. Just suppose, let's make this a 21st century analogy. Suppose you spend the night at the house of a person you don't know very well. You were coming to town and said, hey, anytime you're in town, come spend the night with me. So they call you up and they say, hey, I'm in town. And you say, hey, come spend the night with me. Before he leaves to go to work the next morning, he tells you, hey, refrigerator's yours. Help yourself to whatever. Wish I had time to fix your breakfast. Got to go to work, but help yourself. So you do. You have a bowl of cereal. You pour some milk in. You have a glass of juice. And when he comes home, first thing he does is he goes to the refrigerator and he looks inside. And after he looks inside, he gives you the cold shoulder the rest of the evening. You finally ask him if you had done something wrong, and he says, no, you didn't do anything wrong. I'm sorry. Later in the week, you hear through the gossip chain of friends that, in fact, he was angry with you because you raided his refrigerator. And you respond to your mutual friends and say, he couldn't have been mad at me over that. He told me it was okay. And all the friends chuckle a bit, and they say, hey, you just don't understand. It doesn't matter what he says. Everybody knows he's cheap. He can't help himself. He's a tightwad. Your host knows the proper thing to do is to offer you the contents of his fridge. However, when it comes down to reality, he doesn't embrace that notion at all. For in his heart, he's a cheapskate. He's a miser. He lives consistently with the values and the principles of a begrudging heart. He just can't help himself. Why? Because that's the belief that resides in his heart, not the one that resides in his head. Jesus reinforced this axiom when he said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Randy Frazee shares a story. He said, one day as I returned home from a trip, I crossed paths at the airport with a man from our congregation. He mentioned to me that one of the more recent sermons that I had preached on about a very controversial and countercultural issue. He complimented me by saying, I have heard dozens of sermons on that topic, and I understood what they always said before, but I never bought into it till last week. See, that man understood in his head for years all the other messages. He knew the right answer, but not until last week did he finally, in his heart, embrace what he already knew in his head. You see, you and I are much the same. If we're going to grow in a truth, that truth has to move from our head to our heart so it becomes our way of life. We have a new default chair, if you will. That is why the wisdom writer in Proverbs 4:23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything, what's left out? Nothing. For everything you do flows out of your heart. Therefore, if you want to be like Jesus, we have to think like Jesus from the heart. If you want to experience the fruit of the Spirit in your daily life, you must believe in your heart what the Spirit also believes. If you want to be fit for life in the community that God has formed in Christ with you, then you and I must exercise this heart muscle to pump the beliefs of God from our head to our heart. That is why what we think must eventually move, what we think must move to action. If I believe there is a God, then I will start to worship Him. If I believe this God is personal, I will start to pray and talk with Him. If I believe that I can have an ongoing, permanent relationship with Him, salvation, then I'm going to want to know more about Him, and I will study the Bible. They all go together. Excuse me. Again, we see that what we truly believe begins in the mind. We must think about it, but it isn't part of our lives until it makes this journey and becomes a residence in our heart. This occurs when a belief gets serious. Is it important to believe God? Is it important to believe that this God is personal? Is it important to believe that the Bible is the Word of God and that we find our identity in Christ? Are those truths important? If they are, then we'll begin to act upon those truths with these actions. And it's by putting those two things together, it is believing this in our head. It is by acting with what we know in our head that brings it to our heart. So that as we continue to abide in what we know and act, God produces in us the fruit of His Spirit that makes a difference for others. Let me wrap this up. His name is Bill, not Bill Eccles. You'll recognize very quickly this is a story out of the 60s. His name is Bill. He has wild hair. He only wears t-shirts. Most of the time they've got holes in them. He wears jeans, no shoes. This was literally his wardrobe for his entire four-year college degree. He's intelligent. He's kind of esoteric, though he's very, very bright. While he was attending college, Bill, in a very unusual way, became a Christian. Across the street from the school where he lived, in the dorm, was a very well-dressed conservative church. It probably was Baptist. And that church wanted to develop a ministry to students, but they weren't sure how to go about it, so they just had a sign out front that said, "College students, welcome." One day, Bill decided to see if it was true. So he walked into church, no shoes, jeans, holy t-shirt, wild hair. Service had already started. Bill was late. So he starts down the aisle looking for a seat. Pews are full. No place to sit. He just keeps coming. Service is going on. He just keeps coming. He finally ends up at the front row, looks both directions, no place to sit. So he sits right down in the middle of the aisle on the carpet. Right there. Perfect acceptable behavior for college kids in those days. Just sit. By now, the people in the audience are very uptight. Tension in the air. That's why I know they're Baptists. It's uptight. Tension in the air is thick. And just in case some of you don't know me, my roots are deep being Baptist, okay? So don't get ticked at me. That would also show you're Baptist. About this time, it's about this time the pastor realizes that from way in back of the church, his oldest and longest deacon is slowly his way towards Bill. The deacon's in his 80s, silver gray hair, three-piece suit, godly man, dignified, elegant, courtly. He walks with a cane, and he starts walking down the aisle towards that man, and now he sees everybody's watching this going on, and everybody looks at each other and says, "Oh no, this might not end well." It's awkward, but everybody's thinking, you can't blame this old deacon. He's been here a long time. How can you expect a man of his age and background to understand some college kid parking out on the floor? It takes a long time for the deacon to reach that young man, and the church is now utterly silent. The music has stopped. The preacher can't even begin his sermon. They're listening to the click of the cane on the floor, all eyes focused. The preacher can't even start until the deacon has done what he needs to do, and now they see this elderly man drop his cane on the floor. With great difficulty, in fact, he places his hand on the shoulder of Bill, and the old man makes his way down and sits on the floor. And he puts his arm around Bill, and he looks up at the preacher, and he says, "Let's worship." Everybody chokes up with the emotion, the congregation, and when the minister finally gets control of his own voice, he says, "The sermon that I preached to you today, you will never remember. But what you have just seen, you will never forget." And ladies and gentlemen, that is the difference between a truth that is only in our head and a truth that finds its way to our heart. It is the fruit of the Spirit that will do more to draw your friends and your neighbors and your co-workers to Christ than any sermon I could ever preach on a Sunday morning. The fruit of the Spirit will be the result of the truth that you have allowed, you have chosen to move from here to here. Do you understand a little more why this is important? This is a never-ending part of our journey with God. Let's pray. Our Father, thank you for the life that you share with us, and thank you for the truth that you have preserved for us. And Father, thank you that we're never too young to accept the truth. And Father, thank you for the reminder this week that we are never too old to express the truth. Father, until we take our last breath on the face of this earth, you have a purpose for us. And Father, we should relish the opportunities to accomplish your purpose in our lives, no matter where we are, brand new Christian or long-time maturing saint, whether we're a teenager filled with excitement and enthusiasm, or whether we are an AARP member. Father, as long as we have breath, we have purpose. And Father, the purpose is to let the fruit of your Spirit, love and joy and peace and gentleness and kindness, those are fruits that should be evident in us in growing measure, progressive measure, to our very last day on earth. Help us understand, embrace, and apply these things in our lives for the next bill that might come our way. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, have a great afternoon.